watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the live garden show where we talk about everything about gardens in California, from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. If it grows in your garden, we talk about it. You can give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. Any question about your garden, particularly pest control, plant selection, how to water, how to prune, how to fertilize, whatever it is, you can also email us your questions at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. You can attach photographs. We'll bring them up. We'll take a look at your photographs and talk about your garden. So give us a call. We always like to hear from any viewers out there who have any questions. Now today we'll be talking about integrated pest management, and it's an extension from our lecture last Sunday on insects. Last week was kind of an introduction to all the insects that you might encounter in your garden. Not all of them, but kind of the large groups. And then, so today we'll talk about how to control those insects, and we'll talk about some fungal diseases that also require an integrated approach. We'll get into that in a minute. Now, if you're a student in the class, you need to attend an outside event and write a 1 to 2 page essay about what you learned at that outside event, a garden class, a garden club meeting, whatever it is you want to go to. But we have these upcoming events that you can put on your calendar, get out and enjoy our wonderful blazing heat that we've had the last week or two. But let's take a look at our upcoming events that you can put on your calendar and enjoy our wonderful gardens of Southern California. So the garden tour is coming up. Pacific Coast Highway, Pacific Palisades, and there's the address, 17985, September 18th, 19th, 20th, from 10:30 to 3:30. Call for more information about how this whole tour works at 310-440-7300. Typically, you get to go to a variety, sometimes four or five different private gardens, see what they've done in their gardens, and get some ideas about what you can do in your garden. Get some good plant information or new plant materials that you might be interested in. In addition to that, we have a Third Cities Garden Talks with Lily Singer. We've always kind of bring these up to remind you that this occurs every Thursday. So the next one is September 17th from 9:30 to 12, but it's every Thursday at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on Baldwin across from the racetrack and the mall. This is a paid class. It's a series of lectures. Lily, of course, is a very well-known horticulturalist and writer in Southern California. And she organizes this series of lectures on plant materials and gardening in Southern California. So give them a call at 626-821-3222 to get more information about the class, how much it costs. You can either pay for individual classes or you can pay for the whole series. In addition to that, we have the organic fruit and vegetable gardening class is coming up on September 17th from 9:30 a.m. to 12. This is another paid class, and you can give them a call at 626-821-3222 to inquire more about this particular class. In addition to that, we have one more event. Food preservation is coming up also at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on the 19th, September 19th from 10 to 1, and you can give them a call at 626-821-4623 for more information on how to preserve foods that you might grow in your garden. So last week I had my mystery object on, and as happens occasionally, I end up running out of time to tell you what it was. So let's take a quick look at that before I show you this week's mystery plant this week. But I showed you this last week, and no one called in to guess what it is. This is a disease called crown gall. And these are the galls, and this is, I don't even know the host, but this is typical of crown gall. And it's caused by a bacteria called Agrobacterium tumefaciens. And it's a fascinating relationship or disease that occurs on a lot of plants because it has a very wide host range. Now, it really infects woody shrubs and trees. You see it a lot on plants in the rose family. So on roses, you see it on wisteria. I've seen it on ficus, so it has a huge host range. It is a big problem on some fruit trees in ag production. It can be a problem in your backyard if you get it on your fruit tree or your rose or one of your shrubs. And what happens is the bacteria attaches to a wound and actually moves its DNA into the plant cell. And that DNA incorporates into the nucleus of the plant cell and takes over this plant cell and tells the plant cell to divide rapidly and grow much larger cells than normal. And when you grow rapidly and have big cells, you end up with a tumor or a gall. And so you can see these galls here have formed on this branch, and this is because of infection by Agrobacterium tumefaciens. The fascinating aspect of it, or one of the fascinating aspects of it, is that this was then utilized in order to create genetically modified or transgenic plants. By cloning a gene from another organism, you can put it into the bacteria and then let the bacteria carry it into the plant. So the very first transgenic organisms or plants created were created by using Agrobacterium tumefaciens. There are other ways to do it now as well, but it is still used to transform plants and create genetically modified plants that carry genes from other organisms. So if you see a big clump or growth at the base of a rose bush, wisteria, fruit tree, especially a stone fruit. I've never seen it on citrus or avocado, but I see it a lot on stone fruits. It's a big problem on peach and nectarine. And that's another aspect that's really interesting because it's the first successful example of a biocontrol project for a plant disease. Because there's another species of Agrobacterium called Agrobacterium radiobacter that doesn't cause the gall, but does attach to the wounded cells. And so by dipping the roots of a peach tree, a bare root peach tree, into a bucket of Agrobacterium radiobacter, you block all the attachment sites and you won't get crown gall, at least for a while. If you put a peach tree out, if you plant an orchard of peach trees, you might be planting thousands of trees. And if the bacteria is in the soil, and of course, if you're doing bare root trees, there's going to be wounds on the roots, and those wounds will be attacked or attached by the bacteria, and then you'll get the galls forming on just at the base of the tree, right at the soil line. And if they get it when they're young, it really does hurt the peach tree quite badly, and it'll be stunted, it'll do poorly, you won't get much fruit production. So it can be a big problem in ag production of stone fruits. If you dip your peach tree in the other bacteria, bacteria radiobacter, it blocks those wound sites, and it will put off any crown gall on the tree for 5, maybe even as long as 10 years. And by then the tree's up and healthy and producing a lot of fruit, and you basically have come up with a very good way to deal with this disease. And it's pretty easy to get the radiobacter. I believe they probably pass it around to each other in fruit trees. So our mystery plant today is right here. This is a California native. I do want to bring in more natives and more succulents and things that are really appropriate for Southern California, but anywhere in the state, they'll do quite well. Let's take a look at that. I don't know if you can focus in on these flowers. This is a really nice plant. Of course, this is just a little one. They become a big bush or clump. They get about 1 to 4 feet high and get covered with these orange or red tubular flowers. There's a lot of different named cultivars of this particular plant. So if you recognize this plant, give us a call. I guess I keep moving it, so they're having a hard time focusing on that flower. But there you go. That's a great close-up of the flower. If you recognize this plant, give us a call and take a guess. 1-800-339-1193. I'll tell you that this was purchased at the Thomas Paine Foundation in Sunland just within the last week or two, and I potted it up into a larger pot. So I let it grow in this pot for a little while, and probably, it'd be perfectly fine to put it in the ground too, but I'm just keeping it in a pot for now. That way I can bring it in and share it with you. If I keep it in the ground, then it's hard to share it with the audience. So this gets covered with these red tubular flowers and gives you a lot of color in your garden, and a lot of natives don't do that in the summer, and this does. So give us a call and take a guess what that is. Okay, let's just move that over here. Now, last week we were talking about insects, and that ties into talking about integrated pest management. And I just wanted to show you some, one of the best books for insects. If you're interested in insects, one of the best books you can get is Insects of the Los Angeles Basin by Hoag. Hoag was the curator of entomology at the Los Angeles Natural History Museum in downtown Exposition Park. And I believe there's actually a new version. This is the old edition, and there's a new edition out that shows a praying mantis on the cover rather than this large dragonfly. But this is really a nice book on insects that you're going to find in Southern California. It's going to show you the adult stage here. It'll show you the grubs right here. It gives you some text over here that tells you about the distribution, their life cycle. So it covers, all the flies, beetles, all the different insects that you might find. Not just insects that might be a problem in your garden, but all insects, because it's really just Insects of the Los Angeles Basin by Hoag. So this is really an excellent book if you're interested in insects and figuring out what they are. Let's just set that over there. And now we're going to talk today about IPM. So the University of California has a series of IPM manuals or guides. And I just want to show you a few of them. This is the Integrated Pest Management for Citrus from the University of California Cooperative Extension. And what's really nice about the UC IPM guides is that they cover all aspects of growing the crop or growing that plant material in California. So it covers all the pests, both diseases and insects and any other pests that you might get that occur on that crop in California. It's not just diseases, it's not just insects, but it's everything. It also will talk about watering, fertilization, site selection, planting. It talks about everything. So this is really, if you're into citrus, this is a nice one. They run around $35, and there's about 35 of them, and of course most of them you probably aren't interested in. That's the one on citrus. This is the one for tomatoes. This is the IPM guide for tomatoes. So tomatoes are by far the most popular vegetable grown in gardens. So if you're a big tomato person and you love to grow your tomatoes, this might be a good book for you to get. You can also probably find some of these in the library at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. I don't know if they have a full set there or not. Of course, I have a full set in my laboratory. So that's tomatoes, and let me show you the one for stone fruits. Now this is probably the thickest one out there. This is the Integrated Pest Management Guide for stone fruits. Those are peaches, nectarines, apricots, plums, cherry. They are a basket case of diseases, of course. They get lots of problems. And so if you're into stone fruits, you might be interested in this one. And then this next one is the one for apples and pears. I just wanted to show you some of the ones you're probably more interested in if you're into apples or pears. Into citrus, there's one for tropical fruits that includes avocado and guava and pineapple and things like that. And they have them on the large crops too. They have one for corn, alfalfa, for grains, for cucurbits, which are the squash and melons. And now I just compare that to this particular one, the American Phytopathological Society, which is the organization for plant pathologists. If you're a plant pathologist, you get a degree in plant pathology, then most likely you'll join the APS. I'm a member of APS. And they have a series of publications. And this is the Compendium of Citrus Diseases, second edition. So again, this is a great source of information, but this is for citrus diseases and it's worldwide. So any disease that occurs on citrus will be in here. You can read about the disease, how to diagnose it, what kind of symptoms you can expect, control strategies, and it's got a lot of excellent information in it. So those are basic information for you on how to grow that particular crop. I'll just show you a couple more books. I missed the books last week, so you're getting extra books today. This is Diseases in Trees or Shrubs by Sinclair Lyon and Johnson. Now, this is an rather expensive book, probably well over $100. But it's a great book. And I know for sure there's a copy at the Arboretum in Arcadia, Los Angeles County Arboretum. And this covers most, if not all, of the diseases most people would encounter in their gardens. So diseases of trees and shrubs, I just crack it open and, you know, see what gives you over here, shows you pictures of the symptoms, what you can expect. And over here, you get the text that tells you all about the disease, how to recognize it, what type of control strategies would be effective. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of control for different ones. If I just let it flip to another page, again, you can see the various symptoms on this side over here. And then over here is the text telling you all about the disease. So this is one of the best books you can ever reference for diseases of trees and shrubs. Now, there's a companion book, which is Insects That Feed on Trees and Shrubs, by Johnson and Lyons, so two of the same authors. This is really a companion text. And this is really excellent also. So Insects That Feed on Trees and Shrubs by Johnson and Lyons. Both of these are texts that are well over $100, so most homeowners aren't going to be interested in it. But if we just crack it open, you'll see it's the same format. On this side, they're showing you the insects, the damage they cause to the plant material, and over here, there's the text that tells you all about the insect, its life cycle, and then how to control it. So these are both excellent books. And of course, I have copies, and I refer to them fairly frequently, especially when I want to refresh my memory about a particular disease or learn more about a disease or an insect that I don't have a lot of experience with. So those are our books. Now, the one last book I'll show you, and this is really a nice book, and this, I'm not even sure what it runs. I got this one when I spoke to the Master Gardener class in San Bernardino County. California Master Gardener Handbook. And this is, I actually know a lot of the authors on this book. I don't know Sinclair or Lyon or Johnson, but I do know Dennis Pittenger. I knew him quite well at UC Riverside, and he's the editor on this book. And a lot of the UC Cooperative Extension agents are authors of different chapters or sections in the book. So the California Master Gardener Handbook, this is the book that you use when you go and become a Master Gardener through the University of California or through the county. It's different in different counties on how you get into the Master Gardener programs, and typically, at least in LA County, it's all about helping people grow their own food, establishing school gardens, helping people in community gardens, and educating them on how to grow healthy and good food for you. And that's what it's about in LA County. It's a little different in other counties, but it is a long training. You learn a lot about it. And this has sections on how to water, on you can see it's a pretty good sized book. It's just really excellent, especially the sections on watering. But also there's a section on citrus, there's a section on nut and tree fruits, there's a section on avocado. It's a big book and a lot of information. So, and just to remind you, our textbook is the Sunset Western Garden book. This is the textbook for the class, and this is really the first book that most gardeners should buy in California. It's an encyclopedia of plant materials, plus good sections on pest control and plant uses. So if you don't have any books on gardening, I recommend that you actually get this book first, because it's extremely helpful with a lot of good information. And if I find myself often, I just leaf through the Sunset Western Garden book and read about plants I'm not familiar with. Our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. Give us a call if you have any questions about your garden. If you had a problem, if you want to crow about how well your garden did this year, I love to hear about plants that are healthy and vigorous. And I didn't mention at the beginning of today's show, if you haven't watched before, I'm a plant pathologist and a certified arborist and an agricultural pest control advisor. I've worked at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, at the Los Angeles County Arboretum, and I currently am the plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office. And my laboratory is in Southgate, where we take a look at plants and tell them how they got damaged and how to fix that damage. So let's talk today about integrated pest management. We talked a lot about insects last week. We looked at all the different insects, at least in terms of the broad groups, sucking insects, chewing insects, wood boring insects. There are some root insects. We haven't talked about those much, but they're not particularly common. The common insects, aphids, mealybug, whitefly, thrips, scale, and then you've got your chewing insects, because those are all sucking insects. You got grasshoppers, beetles, caterpillars, leaf miners. Then you got your wood borers, which are pine bark beetles. oak bark beetles. The polyphagous shot hole borer is our newest wood boring beetle that's really a tremendous threat to the urban forest in California. Now we also have the gold spotted oak borer. Some of these insects may turn out to be moths, some of them are beetles, most of them are beetles, but there are moths that are also the caterpillar stage or the larval stage is a wood borer. So we talked about all that. Now that that's important information. You really need to be able to recognize your pest. And I couldn't emphasize this more. The first step to pest control is the correct identification of the pest. If you misidentify the pest, if you misdiagnose the problem, then you don't know if what you're doing is helping, doing nothing at all, or actually making the pest problem worse. So if you have a plant that wilts and you think it's dry and you water it, and in fact it had root rot, you probably just made the root rot worse because you start watering it more and more and more and the root rot gets worse and worse and worse and the plant dies. So it's very important to recognize it. A great example was when I was working at the Arboretum and a nurseryman brought in a sample of camphor. He had had these camphors in his nursery and growing them in 5 gallons and 15 gallons and 24 inch boxes. And he had holes in the leaves, and he assumed since there were holes in the leaves, it must be shot hole disease. Well, shot hole is a disease that affects stone fruits, mostly peaches and nectarines. It can affect apricots and plums and cherries as well, but it's not particularly a problem on those. But it can be a big problem on both apricots but particularly peaches and nectarines. So he thought he had a fungal disease. So he was spraying his camphors with a fungicide. Whoop, where are we? Here we are. He was spraying his camphors with a fungicide and it wasn't getting any control at all. The reason is he had misdiagnosed the problem. He had misidentified his pest. He didn't have shot hole disease. He had Persia mite, which mainly is known from avocado. Persia is the genus for avocado. The avocado that we grow is called Persia americana. That's what avocados are. That's their Latin name. And there's a mite that affects them and feeds on the backs of the leaves and causes yellow spots on the leaves. And then the yellow spots will fall out and you'll get holes in the leaves. And it also goes to camphor trees, which are related to avocados. And so you get holes in the leaves on camphors. So if you see these holes in the leaves in camphors, or if you see yellow spots before the holes, and they're usually right along the veins of the leaf, if you see that, then you need to flip over the leaf and use a little hand lens, and then you'll see the mites. So he was spraying his camphor trees for a fungal disease when his problem was a mite. So he got no control. He was spent all that time and effort and the money it cost to purchase the fungicide and got no control. When he brought it in, I flipped it over. And to tell you the truth, that was the first time I'd seen the mites on camphors. I flipped it over. I saw the mites on the backs of the leaves. I said, "You got mites." Later, I learned that that's the Persia mite. When I investigated it further, that the Persia mite that you usually see on avocados also affects camphor. So that's a good example of a misdiagnosis and a wasted effort, and then having trees with holes in the leaves that are then hard to sell to the public, doesn't usually like to get damaged plant material. But let's get into IPM and talk about the tenets of IPM. IPM is not a single pest control method. It is a series of pest management evaluations, decisions, and controls. And practicing IPM, you are aware of the potential for pest infestation, and you follow basically either 4 or 5 principles. Depends on how you want to split these up. So if you go and look at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, how they defined IPM, they have 4 principles. And one of them is setting an action threshold. And you can rearrange these in any order you want. But the action threshold is really critical, because prior to IPM, and the impetus for IPM was that growers, farmers, especially in the 1950s after World War II, had very, very powerful insecticides that they could spray once in the beginning of the season and have residual activity of maybe 3 months or 4 months or even longer. And they could spray once at the beginning of the season and control all the insects for the rest of the season. Well, that's pretty powerful and pretty attractive, really, if you're a grower. The problem is that they were spraying often when the pest wasn't even present, way before it was necessary to spray, and that these materials tended to have such long residuals They ended up leaching into the water table or running off into streams and lakes, and then affecting non-target organisms. So, you know, great example is DDT, which of course is banned now, ended up in water, ended up in the ocean, and affecting pelicans and various other organisms, you know, insects, birds, fish. It became a big problem. So when we started having all these problems with a lot of use of highly or long-lived insecticides, there was an impetus to say, do we really need to spray the most toxic material before we even go out and look in the field and see if there's an insect there? So the idea behind the action threshold is, when do I need to spray? So the research indicates that, you know, if you just have a few insects on your crop, it won't reduce your yield, so it doesn't pay you to spray anyway. So you wait until you have enough insects that you reach the a threshold where it will reduce yield. That's the concept in ag production. Now, for other types of situations, it may be very low, much lower tolerance of the presence of a pest. But in ag production, if you have a farm and you're growing corn or you're growing potatoes or whatever you're growing, the old idea was, I go out and I spray on March 1st, and I'm going to come back and spray on in May, and I'm going to spray in June on a calendar date. And I'm not even going to go in the field and look for the pest. So the change was, I am going to wait until there's a certain number of insects in the field that I know is sufficiently high to cause damage that now compels me to take an action. So that's called the action threshold. And that's usually the point at which the population of the pest is high enough that you're going to get yield loss. So in order to have that now, you have to have monitoring and you have to identify the pest. That probably should go first in the list, is monitoring and pest identification, because it's absolutely critical that you correctly identify the pest. Plus, you want to know how many are there. And through research, through the University of California Cooperative Extension and through professors on campus, they do a lot of research. They research a crop and a specific pest, and they know that if you have one insect per leaf, that's not enough to affect your yield. And so you go out in March, and you're scouting a couple times a week. You may just collect leaves and count how many insects are on a leaf. You may use a sweep net, sweep it back and forth, and then you're gonna have a protocol. You're not gonna sweep it 20 times, and then on Tuesday, the next week, you're gonna swipe it once. You have to use that net, you know, a certain number of times, like four times over the, and then you're gonna take all the bugs out of the net, you're gonna count the bugs. You're gonna do that a certain number of times throughout the field. These things have to be shown to be effective through research in terms of monitoring the pest population, but you're going to monitor the pest population usually at least once a week and probably two or three times a week. So that's monitoring. So at low levels, you don't bother to control it, but when you monitor it, you hit that action threshold or that economic threshold, then you have to do something. Now, another concept in IPM, of course, is prevention. And that really goes to the fact that IPM starts before you even plant your crop. So prevention starts with selecting resistant plant varieties, site selection, selecting a site that doesn't have the pest, especially for soil-borne diseases and soil-borne pests like nematodes, fusarium wilt, verticillium wilt. If you have a field that has not grown cotton before, then you can come in there and grow your cotton and you won't get verticillium wilt. But you can only grow cotton in a field for about 3 years before the verticillium wilt gets high enough that it's gonna reduce your yield. So prevention is a key strategy in IPM, and it may involve rotation, because that's a strategy and the tactic is rotation. If the strategy is prevention, then the actual action is crop rotation or host resistance. And remember, the number one means to controlling plant disease is resistant plant materials. It's not chemical control. The number one means to controlling insects is usually sprays. Usually you spray for insects. For plant diseases, there's not a lot of effective sprays or chemical controls to begin with. And so usually you're forced using cultural controls and using highly resistant plant materials. And I'll talk more about that in a moment. So then you've got your monitoring and identify the pest. You've got your action threshold. You do things before you even plant the field for prevention, and then you have control. So the idea, why IPM? What's the whole point? The purpose behind IPM is to reduce the use of toxic pesticides in growing plant materials. And so you want to reach for the least toxic materials first that will give you the control that you require. So when you start reaching for a pesticide, you have enough aphids on your citrus tree that you want to control them. What do you reach for first? You want to go for the least toxic materials that do the least damage to the environment and have the least detrimental effect on beneficial insects. So you need a lot of education here. You need a lot of knowledge to correctly implement IPM. You need to be able to identify the pest. You need to know how many pests are enough to take action. You need to know, you know, how can I prevent the pest in the first place? And a lot of times prevention is really for tree crops, citrus and stone fruits, you know, prevention is tough because they're going to come every spring, depending on the pest you're talking about. So for control, you typically want to reach for those soft pesticides first. And so you're going to start, you know, and I'll talk about, you know, all the different insecticides and pesticides you can use. So those are the four things for the US EPA. Now, if you go to other sources and read about IPM, they may show you a little different approach. So if you go to Wikipedia and read about IPM, they talk about an acceptable pest level. That's your action threshold. And so you, first off, you know you can't eradicate the pest, so you're going to live with a few on a few. So IPM holds that wiping out an entire pest population is often impossible, and the attempt can be more costly, environmentally unsafe, and frequently unachievable. So that's about acceptable pest levels. They talk about preventative cultural practices, that's prevention. Monitoring, of course, is key to any IPM program. You have to be looking for the pest on a regular basis. Mechanical controls, they're actually, Wikipedia divides this up too much, to tell the truth. They talk about mechanical controls and biological controls. Those aren't strategies. Those are action, you know, there's strategy and tactics. Mechanical controls is a tactic, it's not a strategy. So you can actually mechanically control insects such as aphids. If you've got a lot of aphids on your rose bush, you can just wash them off with a hose, with a strong stream of water. Aphids have, and most sucking insects in general, can just be washed off plants. And when they're sitting there feeding, you know, aphids and all these sucking insects have a proboscis, and it's like a long tube. It's their mouth. And they poke it into the plant and sit there sucking out the juices of the plant. When you hit them with the water, it knocks them off the plant, but it breaks their mouth part. They'll never feed again. So washing aphids off of plants is very effective, but of course it'll have no residual activity and they can come back rapidly, especially insects that can reproduce parthenogenically, which means without sex. The females lay eggs, the eggs hatch, they become females, and they can just lay eggs and eggs and eggs and eggs, and 1 week you've only got one or two, and 10 days later you've got thousands. So that's the potential of insects, is that their populations can explode rapidly, especially if they don't have to go through sex to have more babies. They talk about biological controls. Again, that's a tactic, not a strategy. But you can try and use biological controls by not disrupting the natural enemies and by using harsh or highly toxic materials. So we'll talk about that in a minute. And then they talk about chemical controls, and in general, all three of these belong just under control, your control options. So synthetic pesticides are generally only used as required and often only at specific times in a pest life cycle. Many of the newer pesticide groups are derived from plants or naturally occurring substances, and further biology-based or ecological techniques are under evaluation. But so that's really kind of IPM in a nutshell. You want to correctly identify your pest and monitor it. You want to have a threshold at which you're going to take action. Then you're going to try preventative measures before you even plant your crop, but then you're going to reach for controls, and you're going to reach for the least toxic material first and reduce the amount of really, really toxic materials in the environment. Now, I have a little video clip that I want to go to, Integrated Pest Management Basics. This is our first video clip. Let's go to this video clip and kind of reiterate what I just told you. And if anyone knows our mystery plant, give us a call. And let me just pull that over here a little bit. Here's our mystery plant. Let's not forget it. But let's take a look at this video clip, and then when we come back, we'll talk about more about integrated pest management and how it's being used in agriculture, especially in California, to reduce the use of pesticides in farming.
Stink bugs, squash bugs, cucumber beetles. Hey, if you're growing vegetables, sooner or later, you're going to have problems with pests in your garden. Hi, I'm the bug guy here for the University of Maryland Extension, and today I'm going to talk about an approach for managing the pests on our plants, which we call integrated pest management. The integrated part comes from the fact that we're going to combine many different tactics and approaches to manage these pests. Hey, we're going to use cultural controls, mechanical controls. We're going to use Mother Nature's hit squad. We call that biological control. And when we have to use pesticides, we're going to try to use the ones that are most environmentally responsible. And in this way, we can produce really healthy, safe vegetables to eat. Step number one in putting together an IPM program is to build your knowledge base. Learn about your plants. Learn about the proper culture, rates of fertilization. How are you going to make your vegetables most productive? In the case of these beans, this beautiful trellis allowed these guys to grow up and just produce bountiful fruit. The other thing to learn, of course, is the pests that are going to attack these vegetables. In the case of beans, one of the major nemesis are the Mexican bean beetles. So learn about the history of these, learn their damage characteristics, how they're going to affect the plant, and that actually learn what the various life stages of these insects look like. Here's the adult Mexican bean beetle. Once you build your knowledge base, then you're ready for step two in your IPM program. Monitoring is the second step in building an IPM program. Monitoring means the regular inspection of your vegetables, and what we're looking for are symptoms and signs of insect activity. Symptoms are things like the defoliation that Mexican bean beetles are causing. Signs are the insect itself. So right here we can see the eggs of the Mexican bean beetle. Sometimes using a hand lens can really help us see very small insects and their eggs, or even mites that are on leaves. If you monitor often and thoroughly, you can really stay on top of these pests. The third step in building an IPM program is decision making. You've gone out, you've monitored your plants, you detected your pests. Now you have to decide if and when it's time to treat. In the case of this tomato, hey, there are a few aphids on the leaf, but guess what? There are some ladybird beetles eating this thing. I'm not doing anything at all. But in the case of this squash vine, I think I see some squash vine borer in here. A single larvae could kill that vine, so I'm going to have to do something right now. Decision making, that's the third cornerstone in building an IPM program. The fourth step in building your IPM program is intervention. In this case, we're going to use a floating row cover as a preventive tactic to exclude pests. Another preventive technique we can use is the use of kaolin clay. This is applied to the leaves of plants. It makes the plants unfavorable. The bugs simply don't go there to feed. A third intervention tactic is the use of biological control. This is simply using Mother Nature's hit squad, the predators, parasites, and pathogens that naturally occur and can reduce pest populations. When we've exhausted all other tactics, we may choose to use a pesticide to help reduce these populations. What we like to use are compounds that are on EPA's reduced risk list, those that are safe to use in organic gardening. Always read your insecticide label and always be careful when you apply pesticides. The fifth and final component of an IPM program is record keeping. Record keeping is used to simply keep track of what you saw in your garden and when you saw it. This will help you be prepared next year to figure out when you need to intervene. Also keep track of how well your interventions work. In this way, you'll know if a biological control or a certain pesticide that you used actually did the job. Record keeping is the fifth and final component of a sound IPM program. So that's it, gang. Remember your five steps of your IPM program. Build your knowledge base, monitor your plants, make decisions. When you see those bad boys, smack them down, intervene, and finally, keep records of what you found. In this way, you're going to be able to produce a beautiful, bountiful, healthy crop of vegetables that are really delicious.
So I kind of like that clip. He really explains it well. They often kind of interchange some of these terms. He talks about intervention. Other people talk about control. That really means the same thing. And so that shows you the approach. Now, just a little bit more about the background of IPM is what I mentioned before. After World War II, there was a lot of development of insecticides that hadn't been really available prior to World War II. And so they were very, very effective, but they were highly toxic and had long, long residuals. In fact, incredibly long residuals. And they were used extensively. But at the same time, plant pathologists didn't have those chemicals. And so they never really relied on chemicals to control their diseases entirely. There were crops where chemicals were effective on certain types of diseases, but in general, if you were a plant pathologist working on a disease, you worked hand in hand with a plant breeder and you bred plants that were resistant to the disease because it didn't pay in most cases, or there just wasn't anything to go out and spray your crop and control that disease. So you had to find resistant plant materials so that's how you control the disease. You put out plants that are highly resistant. There's a lot of examples that goes on today all the time. Every year, the USDA releases new cultivars of wheat that are resistant to wheat stem rust. You can't go out and spray hundreds of square miles of wheat for wheat stem rust. It doesn't pay. It costs more to spray it than you'll ever get harvesting the wheat. So there's no chemical control of wheat stem rust ever employed in the United States. It just doesn't pay to do it. They never do it. They use resistant cultivars or cultivated varieties. Another example, where actually they do use a lot of chemicals, would be powdery mildew in grape. It can be devastating to grape. This is where the knowledge comes in. A lot of times with insects, you can say, I have a couple of aphids, so I'll wait. But on some things, you can't wait. The first time you see it, you need to jump on it right now, today, or in 2 or 3 days or a week, it'll be out of hand and the damage is done. So that's where the knowledge comes in. You know that this pest isn't gonna be bad until I get a lot of them. Or this pest, the second I see it, I have to do something about it. So powdery mildew on grape, the first sign you're going to see is little black lines growing on the stem. And if that's the second you see that, and they almost always are going to see that in the first couple weeks of March, because in March, the grapes start throwing their new canes, this vigorous new growth, it's tender and soft. The powdery mildew gets started, so grape growers know that every spring they're going to have to start controlling the powdery mildew. It's a big problem on grape. It's a problem on a lot of plant materials. And so right off the bat, early March, they're scouting their vineyards. They see the very first signs, that's actually the powdery mildew growing right on it. It's good to note the difference between a symptom and a sign. A sign is the pest itself, like the insect itself, or the spores growing, or the mushrooms from armillaria. Those are signs. Symptoms are wilting, yellow spots, yellow leaves, holes in the leaves. Those are symptoms. So you got to differentiate the two so you understand we're talking the same language. But so in grape, they'll come out, and as soon as they see that first infection in the vineyard, they'll usually use sulfur dust, or they'll use a wettable sulfur. You can use sulfur early in the season before it's hot. It works really well. Then you may come in with an oil, like stylet oil, that's fairly effective against powdery mildews. And then eventually you might come in, you're going to be spraying on, depending on how long you expect the sulfur to last. The sulfur may last 5 days or 10 days. Then you come in with your oil. That may last another 10 days. And then there's a variety of chemical fungicides that can be used, and those will be used throughout the season, but you don't want to keep using the same chemistry. So not chlorothalonil, that is a fungicide that could be used, but they're using the, and I've forgotten the name of the chemicals, but I'll remember it in a minute. But that's just an example in grape. And there's a lot of different chemicals to use, but let's go on and just see what time we got here. Okay, let's talk about a few insects and specific controls that are very, very non-toxic, that are organically registered, and that you can expect to get in your vegetable garden almost every year. Let's talk about caterpillars, because caterpillars from moths, not so much from butterflies, but caterpillars from moths are one of the major pests in agriculture. They cause millions, hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars worth of damage every year on various crops. So when you see your caterpillar, now a lot of times what you're doing in ag production is you have traps out to look for the very first adults that will be trapped, and then you know the adults are out there, so you know they're laying eggs. So then you're going to use what they call a heat index or degree days to know when those eggs are going to hatch. And you want to get your spray on the day before they hatch, so that material is on the leaf right before the eggs hatch. Let's talk about the first material. It's called Bacillus thuringiensis, or BT. It's sold under a lot of different names: Dipel, BioBit, Steward, Thuricide, Monterey, Caterpillar Killer. And it kills all these different caterpillars. And BT is actually a bacteria, Bacillus thuringiensis. And when caterpillars eat it, it poisons them. BT makes a toxin that kills caterpillars. So they eat it, it disrupts their gut. They stop feeding immediately as soon as they eat any BT bacteria. And within 2 or 3 days, it kills them. It's very, very effective, very popular in the organic community. And also, one of the main sources of what you have now are genetically modified crops that carry the BT gene that makes the poison that kills caterpillars, and so they don't have to spray the field. But traditionally, people spray the field. Now, you can just go buy BT, because no one sells you genetically modified tomatoes that get tobacco earworm or tomato hornworms. Tobacco hornworm and tomato hornworm, two different ones. But they're big green caterpillars. And they'll defoliate a tomato plant in a few days if you let them do it. But BT is very, very effective. You want to get it on early in the season, maybe reapply it a couple times. And so there's a couple of different varieties of BT. The Kurstaki strain controls cabbage worm, tomato and tobacco hornworms. It's used on field and forage crops, European corn borer, and alfalfa caterpillar, alfalfa webworm. It's used for leaf rollers, and then on tree and shrubs. You can use it on tent caterpillars, fall webworm, leaf roller. These are all caterpillars. So there's also another strain of BT called Israelensis, and that actually controls mosquitoes, black flies, and fungus gnat. And then there's a San Diego strain that controls the Colorado potato beetle. So even though BT is mostly thought of as a caterpillar control, it also controls some flies and some beetles. It'll also control the elm leaf beetle and the cottonwood leaf beetle. So that's BT. The next kind of insecticide I want to talk about are oils, horticultural oils. You've heard me talk about horticultural oils many times. The caveat, of course, is you cannot use oils when it's over 90 degrees or it'll burn your foliage. So there's Volk oil. That's probably the most common one available in garden centers and nurseries throughout California. Sunspray Ultrafine is also available at almost any garden center. There's stylet oil as well. Now, stylet oil also will help control powdery mildews, rust, black spot, insects, and mites. But you're not going to find that typically in garden centers and nurseries. You're going to have to go online and order that. There's also neem oil. Neem oil is made from the neem tree. It will kill a wide variety of insects. Now, the way the oils kill insects is it prevents them from breathing and they suffocate. So it works quite well. So in addition to those oils, you'll also find now insecticides that contain mint oil or clove oil. There's a lot of them. So that's the oils. Now, typically, oils have to be reapplied fairly frequently. I often say that when you're trying to control these common sucking insects, especially in March and in the spring, you're going to want to spray once a week for about 3 weeks. You might even move it up to every 5 days and spray three times in 15 days or in 2 weeks. When you spray, you're going to kill most of the insects. You might even kill 99% of them, but you're not going to kill them all. You're not going to eradicate them, but you're going to really knock down the population substantially. In a few days, 4 or 5 days, 7 days, some of the eggs that weren't killed, some of the adults that might fly in and land on the bush or tree, they're going to start reproducing, and the pest is going to start to come back. So that's when you hit them again. So you get them early, you hit them again after 5 to 7 days, you do it again after 5 to 7 days. So you get three applications of your oil in a 2 to 3 week period in spring. You can do this on your citrus. You can do it on a lot of vegetable plant materials if you see the aphids coming, particularly citrus, because you're always going to get aphids, mealybug, scale, and whitefly on your citrus every spring. And that's where knowledge and keeping a diary, like that video clip mentioned, keeping a book saying, you know, March 1st, new flush of growth on my citrus, on my orange, my lemon, no bugs found. You know, March 5th, no bugs found. March 10th, aphids everywhere. And so then you do that every year, and you start to get that feel for when you can expect your pest to show up. Now let's talk a little bit about soaps. Soaps have been used to control insects for more than 200 years, and it disrupts the cell membranes of the insects, and they dry out. It does two things, actually. It washes wax off of their bodies. A lot of insects are covered with wax, and it protects them from desiccation or drying out. So if you hit them with soapy water, it washes that wax off their body and they can dry out. Plus, the membranes of insects and membranes of all living things are really composed of a bilayer of a lipid and organic acid. And soaps are fatty acids. So membranes are really fatty acids. And so it'll slip into the membrane and cause it to leak. And so that actually dries out the insect too. So the basic effect of soaps is to dry out the insects, to desiccate them and kill them. So it works very well on soft-bodied insects. But you know, a lot of these things we've talked about, the oils and the soaps, BT, of course, is mostly for caterpillars. But oils and soaps are not so good on insects that are protected, like scale insects have the armored scale insects have a protection over them that prevents the oils and soaps from getting to them and killing them. So, but there's a lot of different soaps on the market. You can use dishwashing soap. Any dishwashing soap will do. There's also safer insecticidal soaps. There's a lot of products that are out there that are soap-based. Now you need to be careful. Certain plants are sensitive to these sprays and may be injured. So if you haven't used a product, and this goes for every product that I may mention any time on this show, if you haven't used it in the past, you want to spray it on one branch or one plant and wait a day or two and see if that product will damage that plant. You want to avoid applying any of this stuff on a hot day. So a lot of this stuff is perfectly safe to use in the spring, but with this heat we had in the last week, if you used an oil, you'd have burned the foliage. So there's a lot of examples where people have used a new product on a plant material. They spray all the plants or the whole tree and then find out that it was sensitive to that product and it damaged it. So that's why you have to be careful. But there's dishwashing soap. I usually use it at anywhere from a teaspoon to a tablespoon to a gallon if I'm using dishwashing soap. So like I said, test one branch or test one plant. If you've got a row of beans, you're just going to spray a couple of the beans at the front of the row, wait a day or two, see, make sure that it didn't hurt the beans, then spray the rest of the row. Now let's move on and talk about pyrethrins and pyrethroids. Pyrethrins are made from chrysanthemum, a species of chrysanthemum. See if I can pronounce it correctly. It's a good one. Cinerifolio is the species. Cinerifolio. So I'll have to work on that one. So it's a species of chrysanthemum, so they refer to this as a botanical insecticide. Pyrethrins are neurotoxins that attack the nervous system of all insects. Most insects are highly susceptible to pyrethrins, so quite low concentrations can be applied. Pyrethrins are quite non-toxic to most mammals, making them among the safest of insecticides and insecticides uses. So pyrethrins get an organic labeling. Pyrethrins rapidly break down after application. Lacewings are naturally tolerant of pyrethroids, but parasitic wasps and predatory mites and beetles are very susceptible to this group of pesticides. A couple of examples, ambush or pounce. But there's a lot of pyrethrins. Now, what are pyrethroids? Pyrethroids are synthetic pyrethrins and are normally not considered organic because they're synthetic. But they're really the same thing as a pyrethrin. They're just synthetically made up. Now, one of the other older materials was rotenone, a botanical insecticide. It was used also as a fish poison in the past. It is derived from a South American species of Lonchocarpus, primarily used for various leaf-feeding caterpillars and beetles, such as cabbage worms and Colorado potato beetle. Moderately toxic to most animals and highly toxic to fish and aquatic life. And that's a good thing to just mention here, is that a lot of these materials may be very non-toxic to mammals, very toxic to insects, but they also tend to be very toxic to fish and sometimes birds. So fish seem to be very, very sensitive to a lot of insecticides, whether they're organically registered or not. So you have to be very careful if this will wash, if when you're applying it, you may wash into a stream or into your own pond. A lot of these things can be very toxic to fish. Read the label carefully, and I can't emphasize that enough. Read the whole label of any product you purchase and follow the directions. If you don't follow the directions, it's likely to either not work at all, or you're going to end up with too concentrated a spray and you're going to burn your plant material. Typically, pyrethrins last about 6 days in the environment. This is rotenone. Rotenone lasts about 6 days in the environment. But rotenone was tied to some human diseases, I think Alzheimer's actually, and is no longer approved for organic production as of 2005. So rotenone is no longer organically registered because of that. Now, let's talk about our next active ingredient is spinosad. Spinosad is made from an actinomycete called Saccharopolyspora spinosa. It was collected from soil in an abandoned rum distillery on the Caribbean island in 1982 by a scientist who was on vacation. It has never been found again anywhere in the world. And spinosad has to be ingested by the insect. They have to eat the plant leaf or plant tissue with spinosad on it, and then it will kill them. So spinosad doesn't work well on sucking insects. It doesn't, if you spray aphids and mealybug with it, it's not gonna work very well. It will also move through the leaf cuticle to reach leaf miner larvae. So it's very good for leaf miners. Does not significantly affect beneficial insects such as lacewing, ladybug beetles, pirate bugs, and predatory mites. So spinosad actually works pretty well in an organic garden. It is organically registered. It's used in a lot of different products. It's used in some bait sprays. The state uses it quite frequently. California Department of Food and Ag uses it quite frequently when they're trying to eradicate or suppress an important new pest because it has very low toxicity to mammals and is highly effective. It is toxic to bees when wet, but is relatively safe for them once it dries. So, And we haven't talked much about bees today, at least, but we've talked about bees a lot in the past. You always want to make sure that when you're spraying, you're not going to adversely affect any pollinators or bees, honeybees or European honeybees. They go home when the sun goes down. They go back to the hive. They don't fly around during the night. So one of the best times to apply is after sundown. You're going to have very little bee activity or none at all as soon as the sun goes down. It'll be the coolest part of the day, so you'll avoid the high heat of the day. So that's a good time to spray, is at the very end of the day, to avoid spraying the bees directly. You do not want to spray in the middle of a day like if your orange tree is in full bloom in March and you want to control insects and you use a pyrethrin and it's covered with bees, you're going to badly damage the bees. You're going to kill the bees. So you wait till the end of the day when the bees have all gone back to the hive and you spray after sunset. And that will go a long way to prevent damaging bees. There are beneficial wasps that can be damaged by spinosad. I've mentioned this before about how you rate the toxicity of of these various chemical controls. But before I go into that, I want to take a break here for station identification. Remind you that you're watching DHTV, Dominguez Hills Television, broadcast from the campus of Cal State University Dominguez Hills in Carson. So it's a beautiful campus. It's a wonderful university. So we have a little station identification clip, and let's see if we're ready to go with that. So let's go with our station identification. When we come back, I'm going to continue talking about various products that you can use to control your insects or plant diseases, and also about some basic information about these types of products. Let's go to this station identification.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website,
csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folk tale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
To DHTV on Tuesday night for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
I chose CSU Dominguez Hills because most of my friends from high school were attending other universities within the area. I wanted to branch off and establish my own network. And that's exactly what I found here at Dominguez Hills, a great network.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
My name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Come to Dominguez Hills is because I'm passionate about sociology and they have a great program here.
broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the class or course or garden TV show where we talk about everything about gardens in California, from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. And today we're talking about integrated pest management. And we've been talking about specific materials that you can use to control specific pests in your garden. We were talking about spinosad. Spinosad is organically registered as of 2003. It's sold under a variety of names, Monterey Garden Insect Spray, Spintor, Conserve, Green Light Lawn and Garden Spray, Spinosad GF120 Fruit Fly Bait. I want to talk about that more in a minute. Spinosad Home and Garden Success. It's used in a lot of products. It's really all the same thing. But GF120 is an interesting product. GF120 Naturalite Fruit Fly Bait. There are some fruit flies, and fruit flies are very difficult to control and deal with. And there's a new one, the spotted wing Drosophila, fairly new in California. And it tends to go to small fruit, particularly caneberries. So cranberries, blackberries, raspberries, it's a big problem on those. It potentially could also affect strawberries, but a friend of mine who works with strawberries says it hasn't been a problem yet. So how do you control them? You use a fruit fly bait. It's also used on olive fruit fly. It can also be used for all the regular fruit flies, Mediterranean fruit fly, Oriental fruit fly. And I'm sure it is used in the quarantine zones when we find those quarantine or actionable fruit flies. But the spotted wing Drosophila is all over the place now. It's established in California. And it's a problem on certain crops, particularly olive and the caneberries. And so how does it work? Well, you spray, and you don't have to spray the whole bush. You just spray part of the bush, like half of it or a few branches. You want a very coarse spray with large droplets because it's a bait. Fruit flies then come and drink from that little droplet, and it's got an attractant that they want to eat. Or drink in this case. It's water with an attractant. Plus, it's got the spinosad, and the spinosad will kill them. So you have to apply it fairly frequently. I think for olive production, they start spraying at pit hardening, which is about mid-June. And then they have to spray about every 5 to 10 days. It's fairly frequent. As soon as it dries up, you need to pretty much spray pretty quickly after that. So they do spray frequently for olive fruit fly. And I'm not sure how often they spray for the caneberries, but probably fairly frequently, at least once a week. And you would spray pretty much the whole season. So it takes a lot of it. You got to spray all the time. We do have a new pest on figs. It's another Drosophila type fruit fly that's called the fig fruit fly. It's native to Africa. It was just discovered within the last few weeks here in LA County. And this product should work on that as well. So GF120 Naturalite Fruit Fly Bait. You can get that. It's legal for you to purchase it. There's no problem with that. You just have to order it over the internet. I haven't seen it sold in nurseries. It says here that when you use spinosad, you have a 4-hour reentry. That's generally true on any product that you spray on a crop. Or, in commercial production, they have reentry periods after you spray a pesticide. You have to stay out of the field for a certain number of hours. The minimum is always 4 hours or until dry. But 4 hours, and if it's wet still, then you can't go in. It's 4 hours and dry. So some products will have a 24-hour or 40-hour reentry period, maybe in a whole week. If you're using a highly toxic material or something that's significantly more toxic than what we've been talking about, these are very, very low toxicity materials we're talking about, then you have to stay out of the field for a certain period of time in order to protect the workers who are going into the field. You can go back in if you are wearing personal protective clothing that would prevent exposure to the pesticide, but that's only for people who are allowed to go back in. Spinosad can last for 1 week, most likely 1 day. In trust formulation of spinosad approved for Organic Farms, Organic Materials Review Institute, OMRI. It's So you might have to buy in trust if you're an actual organic grower. But you can get any of these others if you just want to be organic and not be technically within the regulations. Abamectin is another insecticide that is used in organic production, produced by the soil bacterium Streptomyces abamectinus. I have a hard time pronouncing some of these specific epithets. So it is fairly highly toxic, and I might have spoke too soon when I said it was organic, not approved as an organic pesticide, and very, very expensive. So abamectin, I'm sorry if I said that was organic, it is not organic. Highly toxic formulations have very low toxicity to mammals. Oral LD50 for abamectin in rats is 11 milligrams per kilogram. That's extremely toxic. And let me just talk about that briefly. Well, before I talk about that, let's go to a caller. I see we have our first caller. Let's go to our first caller. Terry, calling from Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yes, I have a question about these native plants I've been planting, manzanita and ceanothus.
Okay.
And they keep dying on me. I was wondering what could be the problem.
Well, that's not uncommon. Our native plants, particularly, you know, the two genera you mentioned, which is manzanita, which is Arctostaphylos, and ceanothus is the genus, but, you know, the common name is mountain lilac. It's not a lilac, but it's a native California shrub. Both of these you find in the chaparral. And they are highly susceptible to root rot caused by water molds, particularly Phytophthora. And many of our gardens, home gardens, have had Phytophthora introduced into them repeatedly over the years on nursery stock, and you know, plants you buy at nurseries. It's an unfortunate truth, but that's just the way it is. So you most likely have Phytophthora either in your soil or the plants got infected during nursery production and have Phytophthora on their root systems. So California natives have no evolutionary development the environment doesn't have Phytophthora. Phytophthora that would not normally occur in chaparral. It's too dry. Phytophthora is a water mold. And so our natives evolved without any resistance to Phytophthora. And so when you move them into an urban garden or into suburbia, and you grow them in your garden, and they get Phytophthora, it kills them. And often the plant will just turn brown and die within a few weeks. Young plants will just sit and not grow. They're stunted, they have poor growth, eventually dying. So there's a couple ways to approach it. One is you want to plant in the fall. The best time to plant is in the fall. And then let the rains water them. And a lot of Phytophthora are not particularly active in the winter months. They're more summer active in warm soils. The other thing, and I do actually recommend this for people who are establishing a new native plant garden, is to treat with one of the chemical controls for Phytophthora. And there's two types of chemicals that control Phytophthora quite nicely. One is called Subdue, and also sold in ag production under the name Ritamil. But Subdue is the ornamental label. The other are the phosphonates, and the first one was Aliette. And both of these are very effective at controlling Phytophthora. And they can be applied, well, depending on which one you choose to use. Subdue is fairly expensive, and you gotta go hunt for it to get it. Aliette is far easier to obtain. And now Aliette, of course, is not the only phosphonate on the market. There's a handful of them. One is called Agrifos. That's probably the easiest one to get. It is sold at a variety of nurseries and garden centers. You can also get phosphorus acid fertilizers, which are basically equivalent to Aliette and Agrifos. And if you're using a phosphonate, you can treat once a month for the first year the plants are in the ground. Probably go ahead and treat your plants before you plant them, and then continue to treat them once a month for the first year. And then you can probably control the Phytophthora by how you water. The number one means of controlling Phytophthora root rot is how often you water the plants. You want to deep water them and give them a period of 2 to 4 weeks to drain and dry out once established. Now, when you plant new plants, typically you got to water them about once a week. And that's the problem with natives. If you put in a new native plant and you're watering it once a week, you're keeping it pretty wet. And that's going to be really favorable to Phytophthora. And that's why it's so important to protect them from Phytophthora during that first year or so that you're trying to get them established. Once they've been in the ground a year, year and a half, 2 years, then you should be able to get away from using Aliette or Agrifos or Subdue. and start controlling it just with cultural practices. And the number one cultural practice is the frequency of irrigation. California natives shouldn't, once established, shouldn't need to be watered more than once a month in the spring and the fall, and at the most every couple of weeks in the summer. But actually, if you don't mind them looking a little ratty, you let them go dry all summer. They don't normally get water during the summer, so they don't really need it. Now, it really depends on the native you're talking about. Arctostaphylos or Manzanita and Ceanothus really can go dry all summer. Although, if you want them to really do well in the landscape, I'd water them once a month in the summer, but give them a deep soak. But before you can get there, you got to get them established. And to get them established, you need to protect them with a chemical control for Phytophthora. The other things that also are very beneficial to control Phytophthora is high levels of calcium, and you can do that by spreading gypsum on the surface of the soil about a quarter inch thick. Gypsum is calcium sulfate. And high organic levels, mulching the surface of the soil with compost about 3 to 4 inches thick will also assist you in several ways. One is the high organic matter inhibits Phytophthora, plus you can water less often if you mulch. So I suspect you probably have root rot if they're dying frequently when you plant them in your garden. That's a very common experience for people trying to grow California natives.
Oh, okay. Should I try to get one of those products then?
Look for Agrifos. That's probably the easiest one to find. There's also some fertilizers that are on the market that are actually the cheapest. There's one called Fosgard from JH Biotech. There's another one from Biagro called Nutrifite. Both of those are fertilizers technically, but they're really just the same thing as Aliette and Agrifos, and they're very inexpensive. Agrifos isn't even all that expensive, and Aliette's a little more expensive. And Aliette used to be sold at Armstrong. I don't know if they're still carrying it, but it was fairly expensive. But the unique aspect of using the phosphonates is that they can be sprayed on the bush. You don't have to use it as a root drench. Although I would definitely apply it as a root drench at early on after you've planted the plants, usually the day you plant or the day after. And then you can do foliar applications thereafter once a month for the first year. And then you'll get your plants established and you won't be losing them left and right.
Okay. Well, I'm going to try that then.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for calling in. And that's a good question because California natives can be difficult to get established in old gardens. When I worked at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, we couldn't grow natives. They just died left and right on us all the time because it's an old garden and it's got a lot of Phytophthora in the soil, various species. There's about 100 species of Phytophthora that are known, that have been described. And it's probably, I know there's 10 to 15 that are common in landscapes.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for that information.
Okay. Thank you for calling in good luck with your garden. So, yeah, that is a good question. I see it all the time. I've seen it for many, many years. Trying to get your California natives established, if you keep losing them, even after, say, you put in a Ceanothus or a Manzanita, and it does okay for the first few years, and you might have put in four or five, then suddenly one dies, and a year later another one dies. Most likely you're going to need to keep treating. In that situation, you're going to need to keep treating those shrubs, those native shrubs, probably quarterly. Spring, summer, fall, with a foliar spray of one of the phosphonates, and that'll do much better. You also might want to add a mycorrhizal fertilizer mix into the hole when you plant. That'll help to get it established. The goal is to get it established. Do we have another phone call? No. So that's the kind of situation there. Now I have another. Before I go on to the broad spectrum insecticides and talk about those, because IPM is not organic pest control. Organic pest control says I'm using everything organic, I'm never going to use any synthetic materials. IPM says I'm going to use the least toxic material first, but I still have to control my pest, and if I have to, I'm going to reach for a broad spectrum insecticide when the situation dictates it and calls for it. Let's look at this next, before I go on to those types of products, let's take a look at our next video clip, IPM in agriculture, to take a look at the actual practical application of IPM in a specific crop. Let's take a look at our next video clip.
...of fruits, vegetables, and nuts has risen sharply in the last decade. The demand for produce grown with fewer pesticides is also on the rise. Along with this new demand, farmers are finding that total reliance on pesticides may cause problems such as pest flareback, pesticide resistance, and groundwater contamination. An increasing number of farmers are turning to an effective approach to pest control, which helps reduce and sometimes eliminates the need for traditional chemical pesticides. It is called Integrated Pest Management, or IPM. IPM incorporates all the methods available for pest control and uses techniques that consider both short-term and long-term effects. In this video, we'll explore why IPM was developed and learn its basic strategies. We'll then see how these strategies are applied in orchards, vegetables, field crops, and strawberries. As with any successful IPM program, it is important to begin with healthy pest-tolerant varieties. Once the strawberry planting is established, it is crucial to begin monitoring for key pests such as spider mites, Liguus bugs, and flower thrips. Two spotted spider mites are found on the undersides of leaves where they feed and lay eggs. When two spotted mite populations reach damaging levels, the strawberry plant becomes stunted with reduced yields and lower quality. In controlling two spotted mites on strawberries, cultural, biological, and chemical means must be considered. Dust from surrounding roads encourages the buildup of spider mites. Therefore, water is applied to the roads to prevent dust. Predatory mites, Phytoselus persimilis, are released annually, early in the season, and monitored throughout the year. When necessary, selective miticides are used in conjunction with the predatory mites for a quicker knockdown of the pest mites. Liguus bugs damage strawberries by feeding on developing seeds, which causes misshapen fruit and reduced yields. Vacuuming techniques have shown promise in reducing populations of Liguus from strawberry fields. The Liguus vacuum is a tractor-mounted suction device which moves over the plant canopy, sucking up Liguus. It is used once or twice a week during the period when Liguus populations are the highest. With the integrated use of predatory mites, selective miticides, and vacuum machines, naturally occurring predatory insects increase to levels capable of controlling the western flower thrips. In this video, we've seen and heard how the practice of integrated pest management is employed in orchards, vegetables, field crops, and strawberries. All of these examples show how the use of the complete farm ecosystem can produce crops just as well as chemical-intensive farming. We've seen how IPM often reduces pesticide use, thereby increasing environmental and worker safety. Integrated pest management in agriculture helps farmers increase their overall pest control while sustaining their land for many generations to come.
So that's a nice clip. It shows you some practical aspects of dealing with, you know, an insect in a specific crop, strawberry. The vacuums work pretty good. The problem with that is, of course, you got to drive through your field twice a week, and that uses a lot of fuel. Plus, you get everything has its drawbacks. I mean, nothing's perfect. And so you're driving through the field twice a week with your tractor. You notice it had big balloon tires. That's because if you drive through your field a lot, you compact the soil. So you get, it's a trade-off. You get a little bit of soil compaction, you're using a little more fuel, but you're not using the pesticides. And if you want to be organic, of course, you're going to get a higher premium for your crop. So let's go ahead and talk about some of the broad-spectrum insecticides. And one of the oldest groups are the organophosphates. And you've almost all heard of malathion or diazinon, perhaps orthine, and all lorsban, dursban with chloropyrifos. which is ag use only. So organophosphates are inhibit neurotransmission. They're neurotoxins. So they're what we call cholerestase inhibitors. They inhibit cholerestase, which is an enzyme used in neuron transmission. And so that's how organophosphates work. Now, diazinon has been pulled, and you can't get it anymore. You can still get malathion, and you can get orthine. Orthine, of course, can be sprayed on plants, and it'll be absorbed into the leaves and last for 30 days. So if you've got a particularly difficult pest on an ornamental, particularly, then orthine may, you know, be pretty effective. I know some of the azalea growers have a big problem with a thrip and some mites, and they prefer orthine. It has the most horrible smell you've ever heard, smelled in your life, and I can't be around it personally. It almost makes me sick just to smell it for a second. But the thing about using organophosphates in the next group I'm going to talk about is they kill everything they touch. So if you spray down your, if you have some diazinon or some malathion left around, and you spray your citrus, it'll very effective at getting rid of all the insects. Probably one spray, and you really just one spray will clean up the whole tree, really, because it's so effective. But you're also going to kill all your other beneficials. You're going to kill any ladybug beetles, any white fly, any lace wings, pirate bugs, those kind of things. You're going to really wipe it out. And you may end up with a bigger pest infestation in a few weeks because you killed off one of your beneficials. So you only reach for that when you really have to. And a good example would be if you have a heavy scale infestation. And then the soaps and oils and pyrethrins just aren't going to do it. So that's when you're kind of forced to do it. Now remember to spray when there's no bee activity in your tree. The other group are the carbamates, and that's carbaryl, which is sold under the name 7. Carbamates are also cholerestase inhibitors. And so often if you get resistance to organophosphates, you'll end up with resistance to carbamates. 7 is still on the market, very, very effective. But again, it is a broad spectrum insecticide, which will knock down everything. But say you've got a hibiscus with a giant whitefly and it's just all over it. Well, you know, soaps and oils will give you some control, but it probably won't be satisfactory. Most people for ornamentals have a much lower tolerance for pest populations than you would in an agricultural setting. Because you can put up with a few on a farm if it's not affecting your yield. But if you've got it on an ornamental in your backyard, you really don't want any. So it becomes a kind of a much more difficult situation in that you have to have a very lower level of pest infestation. Now the other group of pesticides that's very, very popular now are the neonicotinoids. And that includes imidacloprid and other similar chemical pesticides. The neonicotinoids, they're called that because they have the same same mode of action as nicotine. And all the nicotine used to be a very popular insecticide active ingredient. And there's nothing left on the market with nicotine because it was too toxic. You can smoke and poison yourself, but you can't use nicotine to kill insects in your garden. So imidacloprid has an LD50 of 450 milligrams per kilogram. If you don't know what that means, the LD50 is a measure of toxicity, and I was going to mention that earlier when we were talking about the spinosad, which has a very high, or I should say it's very, very low toxicity, but it has a high LD50, because that indicates low toxicity. LD50 is the lethal dose at which 50% of the test animals are killed. So every chemical produced in the world actually is tested this way. Whether it's an industrial chemical or an agricultural pesticide, or a solvent, whatever it is, you want to know how toxic it is. So you have to have a way to test it. So they'll give it to 100 rats, and they keep increasing the dose to the 100 rats until you kill 50 of the rats, and that's the LD50. So it's a way to measure toxicity. It varies according to how it's applied. If you give it orally, if you give it on a dermal exposure, whether you give it to rats, or whether you give it to fish. So all these numbers will vary depending on how you give it and who you're giving it to. Usually these LD50s are based on rats and mice, but then it's very important to know how toxic it is to bees and fish and other things you don't want to kill, non-target organisms. So imidacloprid is highly toxic to bees, and so that's a big issue. The advantage for flea control on dogs and cats, advantage is used in as a control for fleas on dogs and cats, and the active ingredient in advantage is imidacloprid. It's just put as a little drop on the back of their neck, and that will actually be very effective. Now, some people, I've read that some dogs and cats have been allergic to it, but for the most part, it has no adverse effects in dogs and cats. It's sold under the label Merit for Ornamentals for commercial applicators. And for homeowners, you can buy it as Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. And it can be used as a root drench. It's a systemic, and it'll be taken up by your plant material, and it'll be effective for up to 12 months. So this is very effective for ornamental trees, especially large trees, you know, 40, 50, even up to 75 feet. If you have an insect infestation in a very large tree, it becomes very difficult to spray the tree. I mean, how do you spray a 75-foot tree? You need a crane or a basket. And then it's going to be all over the place. It's going to drift on your neighbor's house and his cars. So spraying large trees is really impractical. And so this is a great way to control insects that are affecting large trees. And this is actually what I do recommend for insects on large trees. And if you hire a commercial applicator, he'll use the Merit label. But if you buy it yourself, it's sold as a Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. And you may see various adaptations of that name. But if you ask for a imidacloprid at a nursery, you can get it. In agricultural production, the label is called Admire, and that's for grape, citrus, and vegetable production. So a lot of the produce in California and throughout the United States is treated with Admire. It is very effective on both sucking and chewing insects, so it's not just for one group of insects. It has a similar activity to nicotine. Nicotine is an LD50 of 50 milligrams per kilogram, which is very, very high toxicity. Toxicity like this, LD50s are always reported in milligrams per kilogram body weight. So anything under 50 and lower is highly toxic. So nicotine is banned in the U.S. as an active ingredient for insecticides. Okay, so that's a little bit of repeat. So anyway, let's take a look at another aspect of IPM and take a look at a specific disease that is a problem in California and it can be a problem in your garden, and that's brown rot of peach. Now, peach brown rot is caused by Monolinia fruticola. Let's bring this picture up full screen. And you can see, now this picture is from the UC statewide IPM project. And here you can see this peach, and this all is decayed, and these are all spores in here. And that's brown rot. And let's just talk a little bit more about the disease. It first starts on flowers in the spring. The spores are in the air and they're floating around. Come on back to me. And the spores are in the air, they're floating around, and your peach tree blooms. And this is a big problem on peach and nectarine, not so much on the other stone fruits, but particularly peach and nectarine. And so the flowers open up, and the spores land on the flowers, and they infect the flowers. And then it can destroy the flower entirely, or the flower can make fruit, and you get a green fruit, but it's already infected. Even though it's green and you don't see the infection, there are quiescent infections in the fruit. So the things that you'll see in the flower once they get infected is the anthers die first, then the rest of the flower. You can get extensive blighting of twigs and apricots, cherries, plums, and prunes. Fruit rot first appears as small dark spots. So if you get through the spring and now the fruit starts to ripen in June or July, depends on what kind of peach you're growing or nectarine. You get an early peach, you get late peaches. And you'll see these little tiny brown dots start on the peaches. And then quickly within just a few days, those brown dots become large brown spots and the whole fruit rots. So that's brown rot. And of course, if you get a lot of it, you can lose every fruit on your tree. So what you have are latent infections on the green fruit, and when it starts to ripen, it rots. So when is the time to control this disease? Well, it's in the flower stage. If you don't control the flower stage of this disease, you're not going to control the disease at all. So, and you really can't depend on sprays entirely. It won't work. So how do you control it? Well, number one, let's just go to the next picture and show you what happens to a peach. And you see this was a peach, and it's now called a mummy. The peach gets infected. It shrivels up into this brown mummy. And then that'll stay in the tree or fall to the ground. And then in the spring, it will produce what we call apothecia, or these little cups. Let's go to our next picture, number three. These are brown rot apothecia. And these are little cups. And inside the lining, here's the cup. And in the lining of the cup are these sacs filled with spores from the fungus. And when the wind blows or you bump this, these shoot out in the air and it looks like smoke drifting up from here. This is the mummy here, and these are the apothecia. These form in the spring underneath the canopy of the tree when it is raining. If it's dry, you're not going to get very much of the spore production, and you won't get very much flower infection. But let's go to our next picture, and you can see what happens to the flowers. Here's a flower that was infected, and it's destroyed the whole flower, so you're not going to get any fruit from here. And here's another a flower that was destroyed by brown rot. Take a look at the next one. Is more of the flower blight from brown rot. You can see these flowers are all ruined, and it's making secondary conidia, and that's a secondary inoculum, and these spores can float off in the air and then go land on more flowers and start more infections. So that's brown rot. So how do you control brown rot? Well, number one is you need to clean up your tree. So the fungus can also move from the flower into the twigs. So in the winter, you know, on your stone fruits, you want to prune your stone fruits hard every winter. And one objective or one purpose of that is to remove any infected wood. So if you see a canker, it could be bleeding and gumming. It could be an open spot on the branch where you can see see the wood of the branch itself. You want to prune those out in the winter months. Generally speaking, you remove about 2/3 of the wood every time you prune your peach or your stone fruits. You prune them hard every winter. One of the primary reasons is to remove infected wood. The other is the first response to pruning is rapid new growth, and that new growth will flower more and produce more fruit. So you actually prune them much harder than you would prune ornamental trees or shade trees. So you want to clean up, make sure you don't have any weeds growing underneath your tree. This is what IPM really is. You look at every aspect of growing your tree and figure out how that affects the disease, and you want to have conditions that suppress the disease. So you want to remove all the infected wood when you prune in the winter. You want to have no weeds growing underneath your tree. You want to make sure there's no mummies hanging in the tree or sitting on the ground. If any fruit fell on the ground underneath the tree, you've got to pick that up and get it in the trash and get it out. And if you've got weeds, that's going to make it difficult to find mummies sitting on the ground underneath your peach tree. So no weeds, no mummies, prune out the dead wood. Then, when the tree flowers in March, and if it's raining, if it's not raining, you don't really need to do this, but if it's raining when the tree flowers, then you're probably going to need to spray with a broad-spectrum fungicide, and you spray it what's called first pink. As soon as the flowers start to break up and they're about to open, just the tips of the petals are exposed, and they're pink. So they call that first pink. As soon as the petal tissue is exposed to the air, you've got to get the fungicide on the petals. So these are foliar protectants. They coat the petal with a fungicide. The spore lands on the petal, and if it germinates, it's killed. Or it can't penetrate and infect the flower. So that's really important. Now, if it's dry and it's not raining, then you don't really need to spray, especially in Southern California. But in a lot of places where they grow peaches, Northern California, Oregon, Washington, Georgia, it rains a lot in the spring. And they have a lot of what we call disease pressure, which means the environment is very conducive for the disease. So you've got to protect those flowers when it's blooming. Now, it's only going to bloom for a week or two. So it's usually you have to apply 2 or 3 sprays while it's blooming to prevent the flower stage of the disease. If you don't do that, you're not going to control the disease. So that's critical to controlling the disease. If it's not raining, you don't need to spray. But if it does rain, it's important to spray. If you've had a long history of brown rot on your tree or in your orchard, then you may spray whether it's raining or not because you've had a lot over the past. So that's brown rot in peach, and it's critical to get rid of those mummies, and it's also critical to prune, and then also spray with a broad-spectrum fungicide 2 or 3 times while it's blooming. So let's move on to the next disease. Let's just run through all the diseases that peaches get, because not only will you know, IPM doesn't look at just one disease. You often look at the host, look at all the disease, look at all the insects, and then come up with a whole plan where your actions are benefiting all the, you know, the control of all those pests. So our next one is called peach leaf curl. And let's take a look at this picture. Bring it up full screen. A lot of times you'll get curled peach leaves because they had aphids on them in the spring and they curl them up, but that's not peach leaf curl. This is peach leaf curl, these blisters that form on the leaves. And they're swollen and puffy and they often are pink. Let's see the next picture. There's another picture also showing peach leaf curl. And you can see how it blisters and it often is pink like you see up here. This is a nuisance disease in Southern California. In areas where it rains a lot in the spring, this can cause the tree to defoliate. And if it keeps raining and you don't do any control, then it will defoliate repeatedly. Now this is an interesting disease. It's caused by a fungus called Tephrina deformans. And Tephrina is a primitive or not well evolved fungus. During the winter, it lives on the bark of the tree in a yeast phase. And then in the spring, when the new leaves start to grow and it rains and the yeast phase of it gets splashed onto the leaves and they start growing as a filamentous fungus. And so during the winter when it's on the bark, if you spray with a dormant oil with sulfur and spray the, you know, you've got no leaves on your peach or your nectarine and you spray with a dormant oil and sulfur, you will clean up all the Tephrina that's growing on the bark. Now usually one or two sprays during the winter. One spray if it's a dry winter, two sprays if it's wet that winter, and you will get nearly complete control of peach leaf curl. Of course, here we have often dry winters. We've had four dry winters in a row. And if it doesn't rain much in the spring, this disease kind of just goes away. So it's not a very important disease here in Southern California, but it's very important in wetter areas of the country where peaches are a big crop. Now, our next disease we want to talk about is powdery mildew. Let's bring up our next picture. This is powdery mildew on peach. You see these white spots. You can get it on the foliage. You can get it on the fruit. Take a look at this next picture. This is powdery mildew as well on peach. This is from the statewide IPM website. Take a look at our next picture. This is on a nectarine. The nectarines and peaches are really the same thing. One's fuzzy, one's not. Here's powdery mildew on the fruit. You can get it on the stems. You can get it on the leaves. So it's caused by a fungus called Sferotheca pannosa. Also, Podosferia species cause powdery mildew. It first appears as white net-like growth on leaves or as white patches on fruit. Severely affected leaves may curl and fall off. Do not grow roses close to stone fruits as they share the same powdery mildew. That's pretty interesting. Usually powdery mildews are very host-specific and only go to one crop. But because roses and peaches are both in the rose family, they actually share the same species of powdery mildew. So peach growers will never grow roses anywhere near their orchard. You want to prune to discourage dense canopies, and you do that in the winter. Spray at first sign of powdery mildew. This tends to be true for all the powdery mildews. You're monitoring, you're scouting. As soon as you see powdery mildew start, that's the action threshold. There's really no tolerance for powdery mildew because it will explode on you. If you think, oh, there's just a little bit of powdery mildew, you come back in 5 days, you got a lot of powdery mildew. So there's a variety of products you can use. You can use things like neem oil or stylet oil. You can remove infected foliage. That's not a bad idea. Your first spray can be sulfur, and that's nice because in the early spring it's cool and the sulfur powder or sulfur dust is very effective at controlling powdery mildew, and it'll last for about 5 days, maybe seven. And it's organic. If you like being organic, then sulfur dust and wettable sulfurs are very effective. You can use copper-based fungicides that are also organic. You can also, for powdery mildews, you can use milk and water at a 50-50 milk and water, as little as 10% milk and water. But that works quite well. And you can also use potassium bicarbonate, and there are several registered fungicides, the active ingredient is potassium bicarbonate. Our next disease, let's take a look at our next disease, and that's shot hole. And this is shot hole, bring it up full screen. This is Wilsonomyces carprophilus, and is a major disease of apricot, peaches, nectarines. You can control with fungicides in the fall to control inoculum during the dormant season, which means after leaf fall, you can spray with a broad spectrum fungicide and a dormant oil. And it's really the same treatment you're going to use for peach leaf curl. So the product you use for peach leaf curl, the same that you're going to use for shot hole. And it starts with these lesions in the leaves, and then the center falls out. It'll be like a purple lesion or spot, and then it'll get a little bigger, and the center will fall out, and you'll end up with holes in the leaves. And on the it'll affect the fruit too. Twig and bud blight are the main symptoms on peach and nectarines. Wet years can see fruit lesions. Twig symptoms appear as small purplish black spots, which turn brown as they enlarge, light center with purplish brown margin. Tiny brown bumps develop at the center of each lesion. Bumps are sporadochia, which is the spore producing structure, and can fairly easily be seen with a hand lens. Affected buds, scales turn dark brown and black and are covered with a shiny layer of exuded gum. Shot hole can be distinguished on peach and nectarine by the presence of tan twig lesions with dark margin and profuse gumming. So if you see a lot of gumming on the branches, you need to prune that out fairly quickly. Fruit and leaf symptoms appear much like twig symptoms. Small spots are purple and turn light brown in the center. The center falls out, leaving the shot hole appearance. Shot hole does most of its damage to peaches and nectarines by killing twigs and buds. Infected buds are the most important source of inoculum in apricot, peach, and nectarine. Infected buds are the most, I'm repeating myself, spores are produced during wet weather in winter and spread by splashing rain. 24 hours of continuous wetness is needed for twigs to be infected, shorter for leaves and fruit in the spring. Spores from leaves, twigs, and bugs infect fruit. Disease stops with warm weather. A pathogen survives inside infected buds and twig lesions. Spray with fungicide before wet weather and fall after leaf fall. Usually sufficient to prevent twig and bud infections. Prune out infected wood. So, yes, pruning out the infected wood is really important when you're dealing with stone fruit diseases. And it's important for a couple of reasons, because you want to stimulate new growth, which is going to give you better fruit production. Now, there's a couple other big problems in peaches, and I want to talk about them because I get this problem all the time. And it's the oriental fruit moth. And there's also the peach twig borer. Let's take a look at number 12. This is the oriental fruit moth. You're not going to see this moth because it only flies around at night, and it's a teeny little gray thing. But it lays its eggs on the fruit, and then they burrow into the fruit and go all the way to the pit. And that's how you'll know you've got the oriental fruit moth. Let's take a look at number 13. And you can see here's the larva of the fruit moth, and it's gone all the way to the pit. Here's its trail. It came in from somewhere up here, like this, and it comes to the pit. If you get the codling moth, which doesn't really go to peach very much, it mostly goes to apples, it won't be very deep. It'll just be here. So you can tell the difference between oriental fruit moth and codling moth by where the larva is when you cut your peach in half. Now you got this wound, and you're going to get decay, and it's going to rot the whole peach. So it's hard to control. It'll also affect the tips of the branches. Let's take a look at the next picture. And you can see right here that this branch tip has been killed. And the caterpillar, the larva, is in here. It fed in here and ended up girdling it, and then everything died behind it. This is very common on peaches in Southern California. Plus, there's a second one, the peach twig borer. Let's take a look at our next. But this is the peach twig borer. It's another moth. And it does the same thing, but it doesn't affect the fruit. It can, but it usually doesn't. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is the peach twig borer. It's gotten into the tip and has killed the tip of the branch right here. Oh, keep doing that. Doesn't want me to let me draw a circle. There it is. Anyway, so there's the killed tip. It can get into the fruit, but it doesn't normally get into the fruit much. And this next picture shows the peach twig borer affecting fruit. Here's it tend to get in right around where the branch attached to the stem end of the fruit, and it won't go all the way to the center like the oriental fruit moth. The next insect that you now let's just come back to me briefly, and I'll see if I can explain how to control these two moths. You can spray frequently with BT because it kills caterpillars. You can try that. You can also spray with spinosad, and that might work as well, pretty well. But you're going to have to spray fairly frequently. In commercial production, they put out traps in the spring. And as soon as they trap the first adult moths that are either peach twig or the other one, which is the oriental fruit moth. As soon as they trap the first one, that's day one. They know they're laying eggs. So they're laying eggs out there, and they know how long it'll take those eggs to hatch, depending on heat, how warm it is. And you accumulate what are called degree days. And at a certain number of degree days, it's usually, I think for this particular pest, it's 350, you apply your first spray. The idea is it's gotten warm enough, now you're right, tomorrow those eggs are gonna hatch. You want something sprayed on the tree that will control those larvae as they hatch. As soon as they hatch, they burrow right into the fruit or they burrow right into the twig, and then it's too late to get them. So spraying after, you know, 3 or 4 days after they hatch doesn't work. So you have to be very careful to spray right before they hatch. And to do that, you have to calculate your degree days. And that's kind of a challenge for homeowners. You can go to the UCIPM website, go to peaches, go to ag pests, go to peaches, go to peach twig borer or oriental fruit moth, and they have a degree day calculator for you. But you're gonna see that year after year, you pretty much are gonna be spraying roughly at the same time. Sometime in early March, either the first or second week of March, your first spray. You can use spinosad, you can use BT, and then you're gonna have to repeat those sprays as you accumulate more degree days, because you'll have second generations and more repeat generations as the season goes on. So this is one of the most difficult pests to control in peaches, and it takes a real, you gotta be really right on top of it. You can prune out any of those twigs. If you see it start, prune them out, throw them in the trash, and that'll be helpful. There is one other pest on peach. Let's take a look at 18. Okay, we're down to our last minute. This is a gumming at the base of the trunk caused by the peach borer. It is a wood-boring insect. And let's take a look at it. The next picture is the peach borer adult male. Take a look at our next picture, number 19. There it is. And this is a clear-winged moth. So the way you control this, unfortunately, in commercial production is to spray the trunk with 7 and or with something, maybe bifenthrin under the Onyx label. So those are difficult. Some of these insects are pretty difficult to control, and the integrated control can be very, very difficult. Well, we've run out of time. I'm not sure what we're going to talk about next week, but we'll be back next Sunday for a new episode of Gardens of California. I want to thank our crew over in the control room for all their hard work and coming in on Sunday to present this show to you. You can contact me by emailing the station or contact me at work. Until then, I want to wish you happy gardening. See you next week.